Greetings, everyone. Welcome to Head Part 2. Today we'll be going over the skull, meninges, as well as the dural reflections that are made up by that meninges. So again, we can go ahead and look at our objectives here, make sure you understand those, and if you do have any questions, feel free to reach out. So let's go ahead and take a look at the skull. We've kind of alluded to some of this stuff in our initial lecture for Head 1, but this is really just going to kind of go into the various bones. Now, I will say a lot of the next few images are pretty much just images of the skull itself with bones, and I think you can refer to your lab guides to understand and identify each of those individual components of the bones themselves. And I think that's where you'll be tested primarily on skull bones. But we'll go and look at the basic functions of those, or not even really the functions, but kind of the makeup and some of the highlights of what you should take away for lecture. So looking at the adult cranium, I mentioned before we have two parts, the neurocranium, which is predominantly where our scalp is found, and then the viscerocranium, which is where our face is found. And we already looked at the face and scalp in lecture one for the head. And so now we're going to make up or look into the various parts of each of those bony components. So if we're breaking down the neurocranium, the skull itself has 22 bones total, a mix of paired bones and then singular bones. And the neurocranium, and my little things are off a little bit here, sorry about that. So our neurocranium, we have a singular pair of bones in our frontal, ethmoidal, sphenoid, and occipital will make up the singular components. And then we have paired bones in the temporal and parietal. So you can see here our parietal is actually going to be the top part of our skull. We'll have two of those on either side. And then our temporal is the one here. We have portions of that zygomatic arch coming off. The calvaria is the skull cap. So you actually, if we were to just take that off, and usually do that for like a brain evisceration, that's known as the calvaria. And then the skull base is just this little concave part here, depending on how you're looking at that. But that would be your skull base. That's all part of your neurocranium. The viscerocranium is also made up of a mix of paired bones and singular bones. Our singular bones, we have portions of the ethmoid as well. So remember that ethmoid perpendicular plate comes down. We have the mandible, which is just our singular jaw, and then the vomer, which is part of our nasal cavity as well. Our paired bones are everything else. So we have lacrimal bones, nasal bones, inferior contra bones, maxillary, the maxilla bones is paired, palatine, and then the zygomatic bones all make up the paired structures for our visceral cranium, our face bones. So you see there's a lot more going on with our face, but for the most part, these bones tend to be bilateral, comprising two parts of the whole. So if you're doing the math, that leads to, and remember ethmoid, we don't want to count twice. That's in both the neurocranium and the visceocranium, but that's 22 bones that you should be comfortable with identifying. So go ahead and practice that. I do have my handy dandy skull here, so we can go ahead and use these for our demonstration. But again, our calvarian is actually the top part here. So back in the days of old, they used to use these as like bowls and stuff. So you take the skulls of your enemies and then just repurpose them, you know, kind of like a home and gardens back in the ancient times. Okay, so moving on. Again, a lot of this is just various pictures of the skull. So I'm not going to spend too much time on these. I want you guys to kind of just refer back to your lab guides to go over the bones. But you can see kind of the main ones highlighted here. The various foramens we'll see in this unit, but I'll go into more details on each of those next lecture series, which would be Head 3. Again, I'm trying to build on it rather than just throwing it all at once. As you can see, there's a lot going on to the skull. Even though it's just a singular unit, we have a lot of things that we just have to know. A lot of it just tends to be straight-up memorization, for better or worse, though. So. Here's your lateral view. The one thing I do want to point out in the skull that we should talk about, though, is where our bones kind of connect. So you see these areas where these little jagged lines look like little zippers. Those are referred to as sutures, and they're a fusion point between our skull bones. And so the one we have here, and again, what I'm probably going to do, because I'm getting this whitewash, so I have to fix my white balance a little bit. Let me see if I can do that. There you go, maybe a little bit better, but I could probably do some close-up stuff on this. But what we're looking at here is these sutures that you can kind of see on the skull. And again, I'm trying to make sure, but let's get a little closer on these. So we have our central suture here, which is going to be our sagittal suture. We have our coronal suture. And This is going to be a fusion of our frontal bone and our two parietal bones. Our sagittal suture is a fusion of our two parietal bones here. And the other one I want you to be mindful of is our lambdoid suture, which is a fusion of our occipital bone and our two parietal bones. Okay, those are kind of the main ones that you should be worried about. There are a couple of others. I'm not too worried about those. We'll go ahead and take a look at some of the landmarks later on in our lecture. But for the time being, like I said, I'll just kind of skim through these until we get to those landmarks. But you can see the various areas. And use whatever images are helpful for studying. If you like the ones like these, I personally like these a little bit because they're color-coded and it helps you kind of visualize where the bone structures are. I think go ahead and use these to kind of get your points across. Here's the top view. Again, we can see our occipital bone with our sagittal suture in the middle, our coronal suture, and then we can see part of our lambdoid suture. And the other thing to be mindful of is when these sutures come together, it creates additional landmarks. So here we have a portion called the bregma, which you can see right here, and that's the junction between our coronal suture and our sagittal suture. All right, and then the other point on here that I want you to be mindful of is a vertex. The vertex is literally just the apex of the skull. It doesn't necessarily correspond, so if you see in this view, that's my vertex. But if I show you on the cross-section there, it's kind of about an inch or two postal or distal from the bregma. So that would be our vertex. A couple other points that you should be mindful of is our pterion. This is a junction between our temporal, zygomatic, frontal, and parietal bone, and the sphenoid bone as well. So we've got a lot of bones kind of connecting there, kind of like not really four corners because there's not really four corners. It's an important landmark because there's actually an important artery back there called the middle meningeal artery on the inside. And so fractures that happen in that region, the pterion, tend to be a little more problematic. The lambda is the structure, the junction between the lambdoid suture and the sagittal sinus there, so that's our lambdoid. We also have the inion, tends to be the most prominent feature on our occipital bone here. Let's see if you can see that. The glabella and the nasion. So the glabella is this little smooth portion at the front of the skull here, and our nasion is where the junction between our nasal bone and our frontal bones right there. It's our nasion, and glabella is right there. But those are the landmarks from the skull that I think are kind of the bigger takeaway from this lecture. And then just spend some time looking in, whether it's complete anatomy or anatomy text, and just kind of going through the various bones and then identifying the individual important structures on those bones. So when you're reviewing skull anatomy, I'd say the goal is get comfortable with the main bones and then get comfortable with the various landmarks that they create, as well as any of the openings and fissures and foramen that come about them, and any prominent notches. But all those structures should be indicated in your lab guide. All right, so again, looking at some more images, this is of the inferior skull, and this will be helpful when trying to identify the foramen, especially when you're looking at the interior inferior view of the skull. We'll take a look at that again when we start getting into more detail with the foramen. But I would use the images that, like I said, I think the color coding is helpful to see where the bones kind of stop and where they start, and then identify landmarks off of those individual bones. So I mentioned the calvaria to start. That's part of the neurocranium. So a couple of interesting features to be mindful of on this. So if we're looking at some of the close-up of the anatomy, so you can see your sutures in here as well. So we got our sagittal suture in the middle, and then our coronal suture, and then our lambdoid suture. Also, you can see these little sulci for some of your arterial vessels that are going to be flowing in there. So I mentioned the middle meningeal is a prominent one, so you can kind of see the sulci for where that would go. And those are just kind of embedded into the skull tissue. Additionally, it's hard to really visualize on this skull, but there's a depression here. This depression is part of the superior sagittal sinus that we'll look at, which is part of our venous return, our venous blood return in the skull. Those are made up of our meninges. You also see these little granulation pits in here. Can't really see it on this skull. This is actually just a plastic skull. And you do kind of see, let's see, you know, the diploia, which are these little hollowed areas in the skull. Those are used for a lot of vein, venous return, bridging vessels, basically communication of veins from the outside to the inside of the skull. And you can usually see those kind of where they would transfer between both the internal skull and the external skull. So I mentioned the cranial fossa, at least the anterior cranial fossa, when we were talking about our nasal cavity. So if we're really looking at this, again, on the inside, I'm going to come in, and what we got here is, so this is going to be our anterior cranial fossa. And you can see if I turn that around, it's right up there, right where our superior orbital margin is. Here's our orbit cavity, and then the fossa is just going to be the upper part. So our cerebrum will kind of rest on there. You can see the cribriform plate and the crista galla for our ethmoid bone right there, the start of our nasal, or the top boundary of our nasal cavity. The middle cranial fossa is going to be this junction here. So you can see the middle part. And then our posterior is a little bit deeper, and that's going to be next to the basilar region or our skull base, kind of just before our foramen magnum in our skull there. So those are our three primary cranial fossas that you guys can look over. Nothing too major there other than just keeping track of which foramen are in which fossa. And again, we'll look at those when we start getting into more details about the individual spaces. So here is the internal view. I think this is usually pretty helpful for studying those and just kind of getting your orientation as well. So let me know if you have any questions about reviewing the skull. All right, so lateral view. This is just kind of showing you some of the stuff we might have looked at before. So we got our nasal cavity. Here's our nasal septum. So let's do a quick review, right? So we have our vomer bone. This would be our perpendicular plate. Don't have any nasal cartilage, but it would be right there. You guys remember what that is? Sphenoid sinus, right? So remember, our sinuses are located in our bones for our the same named bone. So the ones we don't see, we don't really see the ethmoid, which would be kind of around there, a little bit anterior with those air sacs. We see our frontal sinus. We don't see our maxillary sinus so well in this image. So, but that's kind of the regions of the skull. Like I said, it doesn't really do much for me to sit here and point out bones in this particular lecture, but if we might be beneficial for me to upload a video of the different regions as well, so you guys can kind of see skull anatomy. But I mentioned initially in the face lecture that we do like to subdivide our head into various regions, and hopefully now you can kind of correlate these regions to the various bones that they correspond to. So frontal region is where the frontal bone is, parietal region, parietal bone, et cetera, et cetera. Like I said, I'm not going to test anyone on these regions. It's just kind of an FYI, and you should be able to easily identify stuff based off of the region name, or if you know the underlying anatomy, you should be able to find it that way as well. So the other thing to look at when we look at skulls is the skulls in infants. They're slightly different. So it takes a little bit of time for those fused portions of the skull to basically become intact and solidified. And so in early development for a newborn, we have what's known as fontanelles. And these are, as the plates of the skull start to form, we have these really soft membranous tissues that connect the bone and basically complete the rest of the calvarium in infants and small children. And so if you ever had or holding a newborn baby, you can notice their hide is a little bit softer on those spots, so they don't really have a lot of protection. This allows for the brain to grow and the skull to kind of accommodate that, because one thing you'll notice in our skulls is it's a very tight space. And as we age, our brains shrink a little bit, so actually it does kind of open up the space for a little bit of motion, which can cause problems at the end of the day. But for the most part, our brain is pretty much taking up all the real estate in our skull, which ultimately can cause other problems when we look at things like brain tumors, which I'll get into a little bit later in the head unit. But the fontanelles basically allow for this growth to happen, because as the brain develops and grows, the fontanelles can respond to that and just kind of continue to bulge. Now, we will see things where conditions like hydrocephalus, if there's a lot of cerebral spinal fluid buildup, children will actually manifest that as a swollen, enlarged head. And that's because their fontanelles are not fused, so their brain can kind of grow to accommodate that kind of pathology. But here you can see basically how those fontanelles work. It's just this membranous portion. Again, there's no fusion. So normally we would see this would be like our sagittal sinus and coronal sinus. It hasn't quite fused yet at that point to make that lockdown brain, essentially. So just be mindful of that. as far as how anatomy will differ in infants, but that's why it allows for our heads to grow as big as they do. All right, so a couple of clinical correlates when looking at skulls is pretty much skull fractures. You can also get tumors and things in the skull, like osteosarcomas and multiple myeloma, but I wouldn't stress about those. The biggest thing to worry about is your skulls. We have a couple of different types. So you either can get a linear skull, which it shows here. A linear skull is basically just a fracture. Sorry, not a linear skull. A linear fracture is just sort of one fracture where the lines radiate out. So in here, it just kind of goes right through our frontal sinus there. Just nice, a very clean cut. So if you were to crack the skull on someone, not that I encourage you to do that, and then the fracture lines just kind of radiate out from that point. That's considered a linear scar. Contrast that to a depressed fracture, where the bone will break, but it'll actually depress inward into the brain cavity. And this, as you might imagine, can cause other issues such as intracranial hemorrhaging, and especially damaging the neurotissue underneath, depending on how much of a pressure was exerted on that depressed region. So these tend to be more common just given the location of the bone rather than just getting straight up splits. So additionally, in more advanced structures, you can get what's known as comminuted, which is the bone basically becoming shattered in those regions. So you'll get a little bit of depression as well as just multiple bone fragments. And again, if you're thinking about our brain cavities, we're getting multiple small fragments of bone put into the neurotissue. Especially if you go in for surgery after the fact, that can be problematic, trying to make sure you get all the pieces out and so it doesn't cause any other issues down the road. And then the other types of fractures you can get are countercoup, which is an interesting type where at the point of injury, you do not have a fracture. So if I were to hit my head on the wall, there would actually be a fracture on the back, and that would be a countercoup. Not that that's common, but you can see these things in specific types of injuries, car injuries and things like that, where it's directly opposite the point of impact, and that would be a countercoup. It's the same with when we talk about injuries. Sometimes we get countercoup brain injuries, where basically the brain falls back, and even though the point of impact was in the front, the brain gets injured in the back, if that makes sense. So it's just basically any injury at the opposite side of the injury site is a countercoup injury. Down here, they talk about basilar skull fractures. So the base of the skull, we kind of made a point of that where that posterior fossa is. So any of these fractures down here are considered basilar skull fractures, and they can be any type of fracture, really. They can just be like a linear. They can be depressed. But because of the density of the bone down there and the location, it's really hard to get a fracture there. So if there's a fracture there, usually it's from some severe force. So it's got to be very strong. And a lot of times we're worried about other issues. So when we deal with skull-based injuries, skull-based tumors and things like that, they create more of a problem because it's a harder area to access with surgery. You can't really get in there because coming out of here is our spinal cord. So we have a lot of important structures here. And additionally, if you are in a site where you're injuring or an area where you're injuring the base of your skull there, chances are there's some kind of cervical or spinal cord injury associated with that. Because you run the risk of potentially severing your spinal cord coming out of that foramen magnum. So that can be problematic as well. So here's a couple of imagings for our fractures. So you can just kind of see this one's non-displaced. It looks like it's more of a linear. Here's some depressed ones. You can see the skull fragments going down. The coronal view makes it a little bit easier. You can see that little bone fragment right down there. A couple of other fracture sites. So you can see the linear fracture. Sorry, gotta find my bearings again, right down there. Not as much of a depression over here. This one is almost like a comminuted because you can see multiple bone fragments. And here, when you get some advanced imaging, you can see how it can invade into that brain tissue there. So it can be problematic. So let's jump into the meninges of the brain. So we saw meninges as its function in the spinal cord region, and it almost functions very similarly into the brain. Ultimately, the goal is protection. It creates a nice little buffer from the outside environment, keeping a lot of the brain's blood supply and fluids associated with the brain where they should be. Additionally, we also get these fluid-filled cavities for the cerebrospinal fluid, which is going to be around this arachnoid space. And so I mentioned those arachnoid granulations, which allow that fluid to basically enter that space and then kind of eject into these venous sinuses. And that's the unique structure for the brain, is that these the meninges becomes very important in part of its venous supply system. It creates what's known as sinuses, which rather than true blue vessels, they basically are just these openings and enlargements and spaces within the meninges that allow the blood from the blood basically to drain back into the jugular veins in the skull. And so we'll take a look at those a little bit later in this lecture, but that's kind of a unique feature of the meninges for the brain. So there's three layers, and again, this is a semi-review. So we have the dura mater, arachnoid matter, and pia mater. So if you're familiar with the root words, dura meaning rough, mater meaning mother. So we have tough mother, spider mother, and then gentle mother. So the dura mater is the outer portion. That's the tough portion, the dense connective tissue, and probably the most protective layer. We can divide that into an external periosteal layer and an internal meningeal layer. And what I mean by that is, it's not a great image, here we go. On here we have our periosteal layer, which is right on the bone. Think osteo and peri meaning around it. So osteo being bone, around the bone. And then we have our meningeal layer, which is gonna be the region that's kind of coming intact with our arachnoid matter there. And it's that split between the periosteal layer and the meningeal layer that helps create these sinuses for our venous return. And that's actually, so they're like kind of contained within the dura mater itself. The arachnoid matter is called arachnoid because it has these spider-like kind of projections. So these arachnoid projections, which again are in here. So we have this subarachnoid space, but arachnoid matter is just underneath our meningeal layer of the dura. And then we have this space, the subarachnoid space, where these arachnoid trabeculae are kind of making up the junction of that. And then the pia mater is going to be the one that invests exact pretty much right on our brain. And we saw that on the spinal cord too. So our entire brain is covered with pia mater. And this is almost nigh impossible to get off the brain. So when you kind of pull off in your brain, first you'll see some of these, if you pull the dura off, you'll see a lot of these granulations on the brain, and that's a lot of your arachnoid matter. And if we peel that off, you can get pia mater. And if we peel that off even more, which is a little more difficult because it's so invested in the neuro tissue, you can actually get the brain tissues here. But these arachnoid granulations, so the goal there is this is where our cerebrospinal fluid will kind of just envelop the brain in this subarachnoid space. And these granulations allow that fluid just to kind of get back into the venous return system, much the same way that the lymphatics work in the rest of the body. So we don't have things like lymph nodes in the brain like we do everywhere else. We actually have the cerebrospinal fluid in these granulation systems. Okay, here's a nice cross section of all that. So you can see the two layers of the dura mater, our arachnoid matter, these little arachnoid trabeculae, and the subarachnoid space. So just be mindful that your subarachnoid space is not your arachnoid matter. That's actually right here. So there is actually a layer of connective tissue that makes up your arachnoid matter, but it also factors in this little trabeculated area in that space, and then your small little pia mater. So a part of this, because of the way the formation of the dura mater goes and that split between the periosteal layer and the meningeal layer, we create something known as these dural reflections. And these kind of help compartmentalize the brain a little bit as those sinuses are forming. So when these layers separate and create these little divisions, basically you'll see those in a brain cavity as just really dense connected tissues of dura mater, kind of filled in between the fissures and the, what's the word I'm looking for? Not cracks, but linear aspects of the brain itself. So the most prominent one you'll see when you open up the skull is called a fox cerebrae, and that's just a central component. So it kind of corresponds to our sagittal suture in the skull, and basically it goes along the sagittal fissure of the cerebrum. And it's just this nice point that kind of separates our left and right hemispheres of the brain. And it anchors from the front near our ethmoid bone all the way back to our occipital prominence. And it just kind of attaches what we'll see as the tentorial cerebellum to kind of create this nice little fan appearance. And I'm going to actually go ahead and show you this structure here because I think this is a good slide. I think this image is probably the best to show initially so you guys can build a picture of what we're looking at here. So this fox cerebrae is the big one kind of on top. It goes through the longitudinal fissure of the brain. And then we have our tentorum cerebelli, and that just goes along the lateral aspect. You'll also have another prominent one that's not pictured, but the fox cerebelli, which will go between the two hemispheres of the cerebellum. So that's ultimately what we're looking at here. And this is all made up of dura mater, essentially. And in between that, we'll see shortly how our sinuses will form. Here's a nice sagittal view. You can see the fox cerebae, this basic dense dura mater separating our hemispheres. You can't really see the tentorium, but if we were to look behind here, it's kind of like fanned out. If you look in the midline, there would also be the fox cerebelli separating the cerebellum hemispheres as well. So the cerebellum tentorum is one that kind of goes laterally, so it kind of attaches along the posterior aspect there. One of the things that is noticeable about this, or a key landmark, is this tentorial notch, which is kind of a free border. And let's go back to our picture here. I guess this isn't the best picture, I thought it was better, but it's basically the point around where the spinal cord can come out. So if we have our dural reflection for the tentorium cerebelli basically covers the bottom half or just above our posterior fossa, that tentorial notch basically just allows for space to go into that foramen magnum. And that's all that was referring to. Fox cerebelli is the same thing as the fox cerebrae. So it's a sagittal division that separates left and right halves. And then the cella diaphragm is what basically keeps the pituitary gland intact. And we would see that over the hypophyseal fossa right here in that area. So basically you have your cella turcica, which is your Turkish saddle, and that's where your pituitary gland would sit. And just above that is a dural reflection referred to as the cellar diaphragm. And that kind of keeps that in. So those are your main ones to be focused on. And again, try to look at these at different angles. This might help to kind of picture it if you combine it with the other one. But again, if we're looking at this picture, this is our fox cerebrae. So there's our cerebrum. So we would technically be able to separate the left and right halves. We've got our fox cerebrae dividing here. This one that's going laterally is our tentorium cerebelli. And that would be separating cerebrum from cerebellum. And then fox cerebelli would be separating left and right halves of your cerebellum. Now, this image does a great job of showing you as that. So remember, there's that periosteal layer of the dura, which is always going to be touching bone. And as these meningeal layers fold in to create that dura, you can see where these little triangle portions are forming. And those are our venous sinuses that are going to have blood supply, basically. So everywhere you see some of these openings is basically like a pseudo vein for the blood to come through. So speaking of the devil, or the blood, I guess we can call it. So over here is our, this would be our superior sagittal sinus, most likely. You could see our superior sagittal suture from the skull. So this would be the formation of our fox cerebrae. So again, we got the meningeal layer kind of diving down. And then the junction between the meningeal layer and the periosteal layer creates this cavity that can be filled with blood. Now that's different from the subarachnoid space. So your cerebral spinal fluid will be here And these granulations allow any excess fluid basically to go into your venous supply. But this is where all your blood from your surrounding brain tissue basically ends up, and then it'll eventually make its way into the internal jugular. All right, so what is a sinus exactly? These are going to be endothelial lined spaces, much like we saw with a blood vessel, that are ultimately going to basically be from those reflections and serve as temporary veins for the blood to basically be funneled out into the internal jugular. Now, they do not have valves like other brains or other veins. They're basically just these openings that allow kind of a transmission of blood to just eventually make its way down into the internal jugular vein, which is an actual vein. So a couple to be mindful of: we have a superior sagittal sinus, so that's the one that's going to be at the superior aspect of our fox cerebrae. So we just looked at that. That would be this one here. So if you picture our fox cerebrae going down, this would be our superior sagittal sinus, and then we have an inferior sagittal sinus. So just remember, sagittal should be midpoint, right? So that should make sense, whether it's superior or inferior. So those are going to be on either the superior aspect or the inferior aspect of the fox cerebrae. A couple of ones to make note of is the straight sinus, a transverse sinus, and our sigmoid sinus. Those are the remaining three big ones. So the straight sinus is basically the posterior aspect of our inferior sagittal sinus, and it's going to drain into what's called the confluence of sinuses. And that's really just this junction in the posterior aspect of the skull here. And again, I can show it on here. So on the inside, let's see if we can see this. Let's just get a little closer. So there's a region, and you can kind of see, this is not working as well. So you see that little indentation? Well, eventually they're all going to converge in the back here, and that's going to create what's known as a confluence of sinuses. And what that is really just a collection point of all our sinuses coming together. So let's take a quick look at an image here. So we have superior sagittal sinus, inferior sagittal sinus. Our straight sagittal sinus is going to basically be a junction between the great cerebral vein, which is going to be kind of an inferior vein on the brain, meets up with the inferior sagittal sinus and creates the straight sinus into the confluence. And the confluence is all these sinuses here. Confluence is going to be made up of the straight sinus, the superior sagittal sinus, and then what's known as these transverse sinuses. So the transverse sinuses are going to be formed by the tentorium cerebelli. So you can kind of see those over here. So remember, this is a coronal section. So this would have to kind of come out towards the back here. But these ones that are on the side are our transverse sinuses. And I know this one looks like they labeled that as the straight sinus, but you can imagine if we went a little, depending on where you look at the cross section, if we go a little more anterior, we'd be in the inferior sagittal sinus as well. So the transverse sinuses are coming around. So the transverse sinus, the straight sinus, and the superior sagittal sinus meet up to form the confluence of sinuses. And I'll go into that a little more detail. And then finally, you have what's known as the sigmoid sinus. And this one I like to just remember, sigmoid is S, and these sinuses tend to have a little S shape to them. So you can kind of see it back here. Basically, after you pass the transverse sinus, you get this little sinus kind of curving around. And that basically goes right until you get to the internal jugular vein. So as soon as you exit the skull through the jugular foramen, you become the internal jugular vein from that sigmoid sinus. And that's the last destination for our sinuses. Here's another great example from above. So we can't really see our superior and inferior sagittal sinus, but you can see the makeup of where our inferior sagittal sinus becomes our straight sinus. The confluence of sinuses is going to be in the back here. And then you have your transverse, and then this little S-shaped sigmoid sinus. And then as soon as right there is going to be our jugular foramen, as soon as that sigmoid sinus passes through, then we've reached into the internal jugular vein. So again, you can use this image, as well as I tried to star the stuff that you should probably be mindful of for this lecture. So another important landmark we should make note of in this region, and a particularly important sinus, is what's known as the cavernous sinus. Now, you would have seen that earlier in this diagram here. I had it starred. And it's really just, it's going to be a sinus that's kind of located around the sphenoid bone, and it's at the anterior aspect of our cerebrum or tentorium cerebellum. And so you can kind of see here, this would be our cavernous sinus. So it's just this collection of blood drainage right around, if you're looking at the important structures here, we have our orbital cavity and we have our nasal cavity kind of in the stridental region. And that's important because when we look at it, the cavernous sinus is just this open pocket of blood. So remember, these sinuses aren't blood vessels themselves. They're basically just a collection of blood. And so in this cavernous sinus, we have like several major structures that are actually just located within it, namely the internal carotid and the carotid plexus. So you get some sympathetic nerves from that. Are a couple of cranial nerves, the ocular motor, trochlear, and then the abducens nerve, as well as some of the trigeminal nerves. So we have a lot of important structures in this cavernous sinus region, in that region, just around the sphenoid sinus. And what that can do is creates what's known as a danger zone in the face. So if our cavernous zone is pretty much just at the base, so you can actually see from the eye here, these veins are about to basically get drained into that cavernous sinus. So it's right behind our orbital fissures here behind the nasal cavity. So over here would be where our cavernous sinus would be. So just given the nature of the blood, we have blood in our orbits and particularly in the facial nerve, there's gonna see some collateral, and we have our facial vein and our angular vein up in this region can have some collateral exchange between the nasal area and the orbit. And what can happen is if you do get an infection in the blood, especially around the nasal cavity, or just even a nasal infection, it can get into the blood in that region and make its way retrogradely into the orbital blood supply and ultimately get into the cavernous sinus and basically be in close proximity to all these important structures here. And so this isn't something that's absolutely common, but it can be an issue with a lot of long-standing and especially very virulent infections in the nasal region. So something to just be mindful of clinically. All right, so that was everything that had to do with the dura matter. Now we'll take a look at the arachnoid matter. And like I said, this one is, it's not the arachnoid space. You gotta be mindful of the fact that there is actually connective tissue associated with that. So if we have our dura here, this is gonna be our arachnoid dura, and this is our subarachnoid space. And so that subarachnoid space is going to be filled up with our cerebral spinal fluid, and that's going to basically be our lymph system for the brain. And ultimately, all that lymph is going to use these granulations that are interjected into the sinus regions to basically just release their cerebral spinal fluid back into the venous supply, which will ultimately make its way back into the blood, just like the lymphatics would. So all that lymph stuff, all that CSF stuff ultimately comes back into the veins and then makes its way through the rest of the body like normal, and then gets distributed through the capillaries. So, and these are the ones where you can see the pits. So if you notice the pits on the image earlier, I didn't really have them on my pretend skull, I guess I'll call it. Those are the ones that you can see from the granulations because they're basically embedded in the blood vessels and can and push on those. And then finally, pia mater, our gentle mother, is this thin matter over our brain here. So here they did a really meticulous dissection, but this was what I was mentioning before, where you can see the pia mater is kind of adhere all over the brain, and then you see all these little granulations which are part of our arachnoid matter. So it's a very thin, and it's going to be the pia mater is going to basically be in these sulci of the brain and covering all the gyri, but it's adhesed closely to the brain, so it's really difficult to get that off completely. It's definitely could be a painstaking process if you're up for it. This one does show a good representation of our fox cerebrae, which you can't really see the cerebrae itself because that would be between the longitudinal fissure. But what you can see is that superior sagittal sinus. Right, so that's basically the formation of that blood return for the brain, the superior region of the brain formed by those dural reflections. So next, let's take a quick look at the diploic veins. So these are veins that are actually within the marrow cavities. And so you saw some of those when I looked at the cross-section of the skull. So these are actually within the marrow, and they kind of like weave their way through the skull in various patterns. And those will actually meet up with emissary veins. So emissary veins are communicating veins. So ultimately, there is communication between the scalp and the venous sinuses within the brain, and that's done through these emissary veins. And so these emissary veins can cause problems in people, especially as you get older and your brain starts to shrink a little bit, means your veins are getting a little more prone to being torn, and we'll take a look at how that can create something like a subdural hematoma shortly afterwards. But when you see these veins going from basically the internal of the skull to the external, those are your emissary veins, and they can also travel through these diploic vein regions within the marrow, so that'd be like a diploic vein component right there. So we looked at the venous return in the meninges, but we haven't quite looked at the arterial supply. And the arterial supply is really straightforward, unlike the sinus system. Everything is pretty much getting blood from the middle meningeal artery. And we talked about that one before when we saw those little sulci on the calvaria and what those basically left an imprint in the skull. And so that becomes important because those will come up, and we remember that spot on the skull called the pterion where your middle meningeal artery is just behind. So this artery tends to be the problematic one when we're dealing with various types of hemorrhages. As far as innervation goes, so this is again going to be sensory innervation. So we talked about sensory innervation in our last lecture coming from the trigeminal nerve, right? And so in this case, it's still going to do the same thing. We get all three branches of the trigeminal nerve providing sensory to the dura. And so basically, between the trigeminal nerve and the cervical plexus, you get complete coverage of our system here. So depending on what region you are, so anteriorly, we'll get V1. In the kind of middle fossa region, we get our maxillary nerve innervation by V2. And then kind of in the lateral posterior area, it's mostly V3. And then all that posterior stuff, just like we saw with the cervical plexus, with the lesser occipital and the greater occipital arteries, our nerves, those sensory innervations are going to be by those cervical plexus, basically C1 to C3 as well. All right, so let's take a look at a couple of clinical correlations before we close this lecture out. The main ones are the types of hematomas you might get. So a hematoma is basically any sort of blood formation or blood clotting in the, in this case, it'll be in the meninges or the cranial space here. So there's going to be either an epidural where your blood is clotting on top of the dura. And so this one tends to be a result of arterial hemorrhage, particularly in the middle meningeal. There's subdural, where the clot is under the dura, but above the arachnoid, so it's not a subarachnoid hemorrhage, which is different because a subarachnoid hemorrhage is actually being a hemorrhage that's in that arachnoid space. So we already talked and looked at the middle meningeal artery and that pterion, so this is kind of a reinforcement of that. And as you can see, the middle meningeal kind of branches off and supplies a lot of that dural structure, that dural nutrition and blood supply. And so if we do get a fracture of that pterion site, we run the risk of rupturing this artery. And as a result, blood is basically going to form on top of that dura, and we get what's known as an epidural hematoma. Now, it's not always going to have to be the middle meningeal artery to make it an epidural hematoma, but it is an artery that gets ruptured because those are all on the outside. So what happens is you create this blood clot that separates, basically pushes the dura away from the skull. And so remember, we should have periosteal dura. I don't know what I'm pointing at there. So remember, we should have the periosteal dura and the meningeal dura. Well, the periosteal is basically getting pushed because this should be above the dura matter completely. And so you can see this clot forming. It is arterial blood supply, so it tends to be under more pressure. And what happens is usually there's a brief period of unconsciousness. So maybe someone hits their head or they have an accident and like they pass out briefly. But then they come back through and they're like, oh no, I'm fine. That was just a weird thing. Don't know what happened, but I feel fine. and ultimately what's going to happen is it's going to keep filling up with blood here. And eventually the patient will undergo, they'll get very tired. They'll eventually drift off into a coma and pass away if it's left untreated. So if you do encounter someone that does have recent head injury and they feel like they're fine, it's always worth getting that checked out because this stuff can grow pretty quickly, if left unattended to. So here you can see the shift of the midline. So one thing we didn't really talk about in this lecture, it's more of a pathology thing, is the brain will undergo what's known as mass effect. What that means is just because of any little minor deviation, so even if this wasn't life-threatening hematoma or a life-threatening issue, it's going to push on the brain and like push the midline or push things through places they shouldn't go. And we already saw not only is the brain tightly packed, but because of those dural reflections, now you have areas where the brain is basically walled off partially. So that can create things called things like herniations, and we'll see a little bit of those. So here you can see this hematoma basically shifted the brain and just pushed it along the midline, which would cause other problems as well if left untreated. So here you can just see a skull fracture over here, and then the formation of that epidural hematoma going there. All right, so subdural hematomas. The difference between these two, so the way I like to teach it is an epidural is usually a rupture of an artery supply, and most of it's got to be above the dura, whereas a subdural is a rupture of a vein. And so these tend to be more common in elderly patients because, as you saw with those emissary veins, they're basically creating a bridge between the skull and the meninges. And well, the skull's not going to go anywhere, but as we get older, our brains start to shrink a little bit. Not as severe as what you might see in Alzheimer's, but in some cases, we'll just get a little bit of shrinkage. And then what happens is any sort of rapid movement, falling down the stairs, getting like in a car accident, could cause a rupture in those brains. And we just see and notice how, like, this area, and we'll actually go ahead and outline it. So our hematoma is quite large, partly because in this case, our periosteal layer of the meninges is intact, but now we've got blood clotting between that. So it's basically creating its own sinus, and that can basically cover the entire brain. Because these tend to be veins and under lower pressure, they go on a lot longer without getting treated. But this basically creates a new space and then can also have some of that mass effect on the brain that you'll see where it starts pushing things over. So it's one of our ventricles. We don't even see the ventricle on the left side there. And then finally, the subarachnoid hemorrhage. These are the big bads in the brain. So you do have blood vessels, as depicted in this illustration here. You have arteries flowing within the brain, especially some of our circolus, our branches for our internal carotid, basically filling out the brain. They can be located in the subarachnoid space. And one of the more common ways for these hemorrhages to occur is something called an aneurysm, or particularly a perianeurysm. And it's just usually a saccular aneurysm that's going to be coming off of some of these blood vessels. And because of that, the wall tends to be a little bit weakened. So under increased pressure, ultimately that can rupture. And in this space, we don't have as much of an issue with mass effect because it's not pushing on the brain, but we can basically just start losing blood rapidly within that subarachnoid space. And so oftentimes when people have these, sometimes the classic sign of a perianeurysm rupture is considered a thunderclap or a thunder headache, where it just becomes like, ah, you're really severe, all of a sudden head pain. And then you start to get like a stiff neck, you lose consciousness relatively quickly. And this just turns to be rapidly fatal if not addressed. And it's hard to address, as you can imagine, because sometimes this stuff is really located at the central aspect of the brain. And so you can't always get there. So subarachnoids tend to be often fatal. Not that they can't be fixed, or if you catch the perianeurysm earlier, you can reinforce the blood vessel to cause hopefully non-issues down the road. All right, here's a couple of interesting images. So here's a CT scan of the hemorrhage forming. And so you can see it's not along our periphery like we saw with the epidural and subdural. Here is a collection, likely from autopsy, of a saccular aneurysm, so that'd be a perianeurysm, but you can see that just looks like a bubble. So you imagine how easy that is for it to burst under increased pressure. Same thing with an angiogram here. They put some contrast in, but normally the vessels should be little linear structures, and this one has gotten quite bulgy. The other thing to mention is herniation. So I talked about the mass effect issues in the skull. Well, because of those dural reflections, basically what's going to happen is the brain's going to do whatever it can if it needs to move out of the way. And so occasionally you get midline shifts if you go underneath that fox cerebrae. So you can see this one here, and three is going underneath the fox cerebrae. there's various types of herniations for the brain depending on what issue you have. So in this case, they have a hematoma that's forming. But this can also occur with brain tumors, even things like a meningioma, which is a benign tumor but can cause issues with mass effect. Some of the infections can lead to it because you have increased intracranial pressure. That can cause edema and swelling, and that can cause your brain tissue to kind of be allocated differently. One of the more problematic ones, actually there's two problematic ones. So in these tentorial herniations, what's happening is your tentorium cerebelli, this structure here on the lateral aspect, basically any mass in the cerebrum or any issues in the cerebrum push the tissue down over that cerebellum or into that cerebellar region. And what can happen is you actually start impinging on some of your cranial nerves, most prominently the oculomotor nerve. And so usually what you'll see is on the same side as the pinching, you get this blown out pupil look and kind of like an inability to gaze because you lose function of the oculomotor because you basically just pinched it off. So it tends to be a more common sign. There's also herniation down by the foramen magnum. And these can be deadly because you're basically impinging on the spinal cord and cutting off some of your main life functions. Because a lot of your brainstem activity actually does our daily activity for just staying alive. So if you get herniation down there, oftentimes that is usually pretty fatal almost immediately because you basically just pinched off some of your sustaining life functions. But that's it. Again, clinical correlations, just be mindful of and how they can affect or be affected by these sort of things and what the meninges plays a role in it. I think that's the only thing you have heard of an objective. But other than that, that's it for head two. Go ahead and jump on to the next one and we'll meet again in head three. Let me know if you have any questions. Thank you for your time.